guys are awesome. What a fun group. Wow, this is amazing. This is going to be so fun tonight. Wow. Well, that was a little tune. It's an original tune called All of Me. And how many cellists do you know that can do that? I'm serious. Is that the most amazing thing you've ever seen?
Wait a minute, John. First of all, how many cellists do you know? I mean, might be a small pool.
And I gotta say, how, like, just sad. How sad is it that Steve has to be known as a piano guy?
Yeah, it's sad.
It's just it's the most awkward name
well,
in show business.
It's awkward for one of us. Let's get that straight.
Oh, I know. And you know, we at the beginning, we didn't think this would ever take off, you know? And when it took off, we tried to change our name. We really did.
Yeah.
But it was too late. We couldn't change it at that point. So please help me make it up to the coolest cellist in the whole world. That's not what's worthy.
Come on.
We're not worthy.
Stop it. John, that was a really nice failed attempt at making up for the name. Thank you. That was kind of you. And I do appreciate the empathy because really, you don't know what it's like to wake up every day and look in the mirror and say to yourself, I'm false advertising. That's what I am. But you know what? I've come across something that I think is going to clear all this up, John. It's good. You're going to be really excited about this. I've actually been doing a little genealogical research. And I've discovered if you go far back enough, you can find a common ancestor that the cello and piano share. The tree.
That is helpful.
Even though I'm excluded from the name, I'm still family, and isn't that what matters in the end?
Such a good sport.
That's what matters in the end. So we're family. We're family, John. We're family. Yeah, and family, you know, in family, anything goes, you know, it's fine, yeah. How many out there enjoy a little classical music? I want to ask that question. Too bad. No, if you know anything about us, you know we love classical music. In fact, we think it's the ancestor of all the music we listen to today. So when we pair it with the music of today, it's like a happy family reunion, minus the Kentucky Fried Chicken. I love it. And you know, we'd love to take classical music and fold it into some film score arrangements or inject it into our original material or sprinkle it into pop tunes. In fact, we'll take classical music itself and turn it on its head. It's cool no matter what way we play it. It's so fun to come at every angle.
Actually, Steve, speaking of turning it on its head, there's something I need to do real quick.
Okay, go ahead.
Because it ties in with that.
Okay.
So, just a sec.
Okay.
Representations of everything Steve says.
Yeah, so. Right, okay, that sounds like a nightmare. You know, actually, John, I've been meaning to tell you, I've actually been experimenting with playing the cello upside down. The first time I did it, it went really well, except for, you know, several days later, I woke up in the hospital.
Steve, you gotta stop that. Yeah, that's dangerous.
Yeah, but don't do that at home if you're a cellist. Well, how many out there, this is so fun to be back in San Jose again. Thanks for filling this great place and bringing us back. We love this place. How many of you have been to one of our shows before? Just give us an idea.
That's the first time anyone's ever come back. Thank you.
How many of you have never been to one of our shows? You're seeing us first live. Well, buckle up. You know, John, that's a lot of people that have never seen us before. I'm wondering, for this, for their sake, could I introduce my cello family to the audience?
We gotta do it.
Okay, sure. And I should back up first. I should tell you that when I started playing with the piano guys, I had one cello. Makes sense, right? Now I have 35 cellos.
We are a little worried about Steve.
I think you should be. And it didn't just stop there. I became obsessed and I started to accessorize. I got things like cello stands and bows everywhere. Look at all these effects pedals I have mounting up here. Cables running everywhere. Kick drum. I mean, that's an accessory right there. And then I even got a pianist.
Okay, that's something that's gonna happen all night. Just it's fun though, because we've been playing for 20 years together. We are like brothers on stage. And we love each other. Nothing to worry about. And I'm honored to be your accompanist, by the way.
You know, 20 years, I cannot believe that. I still remember when we met. I was 13 and you were 47. It was a beautiful moment.
Easy.
Oh, this is going to be fun. He's right. This whole cello-piano brotherly rivalry thing that I'm winning, it is just for fun. It really is. Especially for one of us. So, getting back to the cellos. Why 35? There's a very good reason for this. I'm glad you asked. Because each of these cellos have a distinct purpose. They're all built from different materials. They aren't just the same thing over and over again. They're built from different materials. I string them differently, tune them differently, I play each of them differently, and that is how we accomplish what we hope you know is the signature sound of the piano guys. It's piano alongside invented textures you've never heard before on all 35 of these myriad cellos. And they have so much personality. They're bursting with it, in fact, that we give all of them names. So I have three with me tonight. This one right here. This is the kind of cello you're used to seeing. This is my 100-year-old wood cello, and he is Italian. So of course, being Italian, we had to name him Marcello.
Marcello.
He liked the pasta. This one right here, this is my French cello, and she is made from carbon fiber. Nearly indestructible. Now, of course, being French and carbon fiber, you would also name her this. Her name is Carmen Fibre. This one right here, this is one of my favorites. This is my Chinese cello. Bruce Lee. I now have a white electric cello named Chuck Norris. You should see the two duet. It's crazy. Let me tell you a couple things about Bruce. First of all, those who are astute among you probably already recognize that instead of the traditional four strings, Bruce has an extra fifth higher string, allowing me to get into the violin range. In addition to that, he's a custom cello. And instead of having, you see, he's just like an ordinary cello that's gone through a severe weight loss program. It's because of, instead of having a body to reverberate the sound, we're using an electric pickup which sits underneath the bridge. And that electric pickup, which is also custom, captures the bow sounds, the pizzicato, plus any ambient sounds as well. Which opens up all kinds of ADHD possibilities. So I'm gonna demonstrate him for you here, okay? I've got him plugged into a bunch of gear. This is like an effects pedal that a guitarist, electric guitarist, would use. You hear kind of the delay there. This one right here, if you've never seen one of these, this is a loop pedal. Now what I'm gonna do during this next one, we're gonna do an improvisation, which I think we've done it in San Jose before, but we do it differently every time, because of course it's an improvisation. I'm going to be playing the cello. I'll hit a button with my foot. It'll record a segment of what I'm playing. I'll hit that button again. It'll loop what I've just recorded, creating, and I can do that multiple times, stacking multiple parts live. That's why it's so much fun. In fact, John, you should totally get one of these.
Actually, no one knows what the middle pedal does. Anyone? See, no one knows.
I don't know.
It could be a loop pedal.
Maybe it is. God, we've solved that ancient mystery. Okay, so we're going to... Any U2 fans out there? I'm hoping there's some U2 fans. Good. This is our loop pedal-inspired improvisation, piano guy style, of our favorite U2 tune, With or Without You. Thank you.
I can do cool things.
Go ahead.
Steve, you know what would be helpful is to tell the story behind the piano, guys. Oh. Clear up a little confusion.
Okay, that's a good idea.
Save a little face.
And give a little context to the purpose behind our genesis. I think that's... And some of you may have heard parts of this story before. I hope it merits a retelling for those that haven't. Because this is often the number one question we get asked. Why are you called the Piano Guys? In fact, I get asked a lot more than you do, I imagine. We actually began as a little piano store in a tiny little town called St. George in southern Utah. This is a town nestled right outside of Zion National Park. It's a beautiful place. In fact, it's a bucket list place. It really is. And wow, two people agree with me. That's great. If that doesn't sell you, I don't know what will. So it is just an incredible place. But inside this beautiful town, inside that piano store, was this owner of that store named Paul Anderson. One day, woke up and just started feeling fatigued, felt tired of advertising and selling his pianos the same way everybody else was selling them. Places you'd expect to see advertisements, or you have seen them, right? You, up on a billboard in a newspaper ad or on the radio, you're hearing about this big piano blowout that you can't miss out on. And he thought, I'm going to put all of that aside and risk it all instead and try to sell pianos through social media. And around this time, he was just cogitating over this crazy idea. John happens to waltz into his piano store because he had a gig in that area, in the St. George area, and needed a piano to practice on in preparation for that gig. And Paul welcomes him in and says, oh yeah, John, have it any piano you like. Go ahead, practice away. Be my guest. But I love the way you play the piano, John. I've got this crazy idea. Could I film you playing on my store pianos? And we'll upload the videos that I filmed to this social media channel, this YouTube channel I've created and called
The Piano Guys.
That's a little slow. Kidding. Yes, you're right. Now you see where the name came from. The Piano Guys, the name of the YouTube channel. That's right. And then Paul takes John by the shoulders and shakes him with this little twitch in his eye. And then he says, and then, John, we will sell many pianos. And John catches this infectious vision. He pulls me in. Now, as you know, we'd been playing together for some time, even at that point. And I, at the same time, had serendipitously moved onto the same street as Al Vanderbeek, music producer. He and I were jamming in his studio together, recording music. Now, in no time, all four of us had all the necessary tools to build this YouTube channel without outsourcing anything. And remember, we were just doing this for fun, had no idea it would go anywhere, just trying to sell a few pianos on the side, really. Fast forward to today. Now we have over 80 videos on YouTube with 1.8 billion views, 8 albums with Sony, and we still haven't sold a piano.
Inspirational moment for you. Paul's piano store is now closed, actually.
Sad. But cello sales are up. So, but in the beginning, despite all that, Paul's vision was indomitable. He wanted to take the piano and cello out of their concert hall context, in which you're used to seeing them, and put them in places these instruments have never been, never ventured, and you'd never imagine seeing them in these places. He said, let's put them on a speeding train, or a cliff's edge, or on a beach. And then he just got really excited and said, then we're gonna do all 7 wonders of the world. Yeah. We said, Paul, put the Mountain Dew down. Let's have a rational conversation. But as much as we teased him, his vision proved prophetic, because there we were not long ago with a full-size grand piano and a cello. First time anybody's ever done this. Where? On our first wonder, the Great Wall of China.
Crazy.
Thank you. Yeah, I still can't believe that actually happened. And the funny thing about it is that, you know, we had taken care of all of the minor details, like, permission from the Chinese government, things like that. But 2 weeks before we were going to go on tour, and we were going to film this video at the end of the tour, we still had no idea what we were going to play.
Oh, yeah.
When we got there, we had been racking our brains for weeks.